Hi everyone, Omar is here. Today we're filling a gap in the old Windows on modern hardware series by checking out the missing piece, Windows 8. More specifically, we're building a Windows 8.1 PC on modern hardware using a big E-ATX case and a brand new 27-inch IPS 144Hz display that I just received from Titan Army. More on that later. So far, I've tested almost every Windows version on modern hardware, but somehow Windows 8 was not on the list, despite being requested a few times. Why? Well, Windows 8 isn't that old, and theoretically it should install on modern hardware without any issues, so there is not much to add to the story. But hold on, Windows 8 isn't exactly new either, since it was released back in 2012, followed a year later by Windows 8.1, which we'll be using today. For simplicity, we'll just call it Windows 8, but we know it's the 0.1 update. Now let's talk about hardware. We have a socket 1700 setup, which is about 10 years newer than Windows 8, so there may be some issues to troubleshoot. I wouldn't know for sure since I haven't used Windows 8 in a while, but I do have fond memories of it, despite not being thrilled about the missing start button and the shift to apps instead of classic software. However, I did like the fresh new interface overall. I still remember using it for the first time on a brand new 24-inch 60Hz IPS display. I had actually wanted a 27-inch monitor, but back then I wasn't sure about pixel density, and let's be honest, those larger screens were pricey. By the time I finally upgraded my monitor, I was already on Windows 10, but no worries, now I've got the chance to experience it all over again on this Titan Army 27-inch display. So how did I get it? Well, Titan Army emailed me asking if I wanted to check out their P2718C model. I said sure, I could use it in one of my videos, but there won't be a full review. They were cool with that. The only thing, literally the only thing, they asked was to include a link into the description. No requirements, no obligations. As a brand, they are more popular in China, known for delivering high-spec gaming monitors at low prices, which you kinda have to do to stay in business over there. The P2718C is one of their value options. I mean, for just $109, you get a 1 millisecond IPS panel with 144Hz refresh rate and adaptive sync. But being a budget model, there is no RGB lighting, no premium accessories, and definitely no fancy stand. The included stand only supports tilt adjustment, though it does have a VESA mount on the back if you want to upgrade. The best part is the panel itself. It's edge lit, but being a 2025 panel, you won't see the kind of light bleeding you'd get with panels from 5 years ago. No dead pixels either, which is always a good sign. It also has a built-in low blue light tech, likely using a physical filter or coating instead of software-based color shifting. That means a better image quality and more accurate colors. The brightness peaks at 350 nits, which is pretty standard for this price range. Now let's proceed with the installation. Windows 8 has native support for USB 3, so that should make things a lot easier. If not, I have a plan B, since I already plugged in a PCIe to USB 2 and a PS2 adapter, just in case the USB 3X controller isn't recognized for whatever reason. Windows 8.1 also includes native NVMe support, but if the drive still isn't detected, I've got a few backup options, like a PCIe M.2 SSD that runs on the AACI protocol, which has been natively supported since Windows Vista. Of course, I could also use a standard SATA SSD and an optical drive, but that would be too easy. The real challenge here is to see if we can get Windows 8.1 installed using the onboard USB 3X ports and an NVMe SSD, pretty much like we are doing it with Windows 10 or 11. So I guess all we really need is to get Windows 8.1 onto a USB stick. For this part, I used a brand new USB 3.2 Lexar drive and the good old Rufus. I made it bootable for CSM because of course I'm going to run Windows 98 and even Windows 3.1 on the system. That's why I installed a PCI sound card too, but this is totally unnecessary for Windows 8. Also, all my backup plans for this setup turned out to be unnecessary. Windows 8.1 had no issues with the USB 3.2 Gen 1 controller from the Intel H610 chipset, nor with the NVMe drive. Everything just worked and no internet connection was required during the installation. But data collection, you know, in order to make the world a better place, had already begun. Once I saw the desktop, I plugged in an N300 Wi-Fi USB stick. These 300 megabit adapters were very popular during the Windows 8 days. And yes, the adapter was recognized instantly. Then it was time to check if Windows updates were still working. Updates are still available for Windows 7, but we need manually to download and install some core updates first in order to communicate with Microsoft's servers. I was expecting a similar approach in Windows 8, but no, the updates just appeared, and a major security update was released on that very day I did the installation. For a moment, I wasn't sure what version of Windows I had actually installed, but after double-checking, it was indeed Windows 8.1. Windows Server 2012 R2 is based on Windows 8 and is set to receive security updates until October 2026, so this should work on Windows 8 as well. Now let's go back on our hardware. I initially started the installation with a GeForce 7900GS card. I assumed it would be recognized during the installation so we can get into Full HD earlier, like in Windows Vista, but that wasn't the case. Next, I tried an RTX 2060 Super card. We can use up to the 3000 series, just like in Windows 7. However, we must use the Windows 7 driver as NVIDIA did not list Windows 8 as compatible with RTX cards. Since Windows 8 is limited to DirectX 11.2, we can't use RTX features through the DirectX 12 API, which is how most RTX games do business in Windows. So no RTX, except for games that utilize RTX features via the Vulkan API, such as Quake II RTX. That means I could enjoy one of my favorite games in Windows 8, and on top of that, the latest release from just a few months ago worked perfectly fine. Just take a look. Now let me switch back to our Titan Army monitor, but filming the screen isn't the best way to show how good the image quality really is. Camera settings like aperture, shutter speed and white balance can all mess with how it looks on video. Plus screens can flicker or show moiré patterns on camera that you don't see in real life. But anyway, Full HD still looks great to me on a 27-inch display. On a 32-inch, the pixel density starts to feel a bit low, but I think I could get used to it if I used it long enough. Now back to Windows 8. When it comes to browsing, it's all good. The latest version of Supermium works just fine, or we can go with Mozilla Firefox 115 ESR. Even the included Edge browser updated itself to a 2023 version, which is more than enough for YouTube and general social media. I mean, those are usually the pickiest when it comes to browser support and security. And speaking of updated software, I had to check System Information Viewer, or SIV. I actually chatted with Ray, the creator of SIV, and asked if it would be possible to add a more condensed system summary feature. He was like, yeah, sure, why not? And yep, it's there now. So I guess I have to switch from showing HV info screens to SIV. I kinda asked for it. Now I guess it's time to end the video. Overall, it was a fun ride revisiting Windows 8. It's fast, stable, and handles a modern setup surprisingly well. As of 2025, we can't say it's been completely put out of business since updates are still working. However, when it comes to gaming, the lack of DirectX 12 cuts off access to many great games, which it's a shame, especially when you have the option to install powerful NVIDIA RTX cards. There are some workarounds though, like the XVK, which runs DirectX 12 through Vulkan, but I'm not sure it's worth the trouble. As for this Titan Army monitor, it's a great example on how large, well-built displays have become really affordable. And if only that were the case with GPUs. That's all for today. I hope you enjoyed the video. Let me know in the comments which Windows version I should cover next. I'm thinking either Windows 3.0 from 1990 or maybe Windows XP x64. Thanks for watching. Omores out.